Hello everyone, welcome back to the virtual class of ISC class 8 history. So today I'm going to teach you chapter number 13, that is the Indian National Movement from 1885 to 1916. Okay, so I hope you all have gone through the previous tutorials and all. So as you all know that Indian National Congress was founded in the year 1885. Okay, so in the year 1885, Indian National Congress was founded, and the first president of Indian National Congress was W.C. Banerjee. And the first session of Indian National Congress was held at Mumbai, where 72 delegates attended it, and then they passed a resolution. So what were the immediate objectives of Indian National Congress? To arouse political consciousness among the people, okay, to maintain a friendly relation among the Congress workers living in different parts of the country, and then to place their demands, okay, to place their demands in front of the English in a very constitutional way. With that motive, the Indian National Congress was started. So today in this chapter, we'll discuss about so many topics, like the for activities of the moderates also we'll discuss. So within this video, within this chapter, we'll discuss about moderates also, assertive nationalists also, then partition of Bengal, formation of Muslim League, all these things we are going to do it together in this video. Okay, so I'm going to share you the screen. Okay, so here we are with chapter number 13, the Indian National Movement. This is the chapter we are going to do. Okay, this is the chapter we will be doing it. So in this chapter, we'll discuss about the different phases of Indian National Movement. Okay, now you can see here that the first phase of Indian National Movement. Okay, so altogether three phases we have. The first phase is the early moderate phase, early nationalist phase from 1885 to 1905. And then the second one is the assertive phase. And the third one is the Gandhian phase. So in this chapter, we'll discuss only about the two phases, early nationalist phase from 1885 to 1905. So who were called moderates? The early nationalists were called moderates. Why were they called moderates? Why were they called moderates? Okay, so we know that early nationalist from 1885 to 1905, they were called moderates. Why? Because they were moderate in their attitude. They had a moderate demands. Their demands were very, very moderate in nature. Their method of objectives, methods were also very, very moderate. They were highly educated people, so they had a lot of patience in them. That is why they were termed as moderates. Okay. So the adjective used over here for the early congressman is the moderate. Okay, so the early nationalists from 1885 to 1905 were called moderates. Okay, so this is the one, 1885 to 1905. Okay, 1885 to 1905, the early congressman, they were called as moderates. Okay, so let me tell you who were these people. So it is mentioned over here that the members of the Congress, you can see here, the members of the Congress during the early nationalist phase belonged mainly to the educated middle class. They were intellectual. They belonged to the intellectual community. So who were they? Lawyers were there, teachers were there, journalists were there. Okay, then officials were there, professionals were there, industrialists were there, so many others. Okay, so though they were highly intellectuals, they belong to the intellectual community. Okay, so now you can see the pictures of two eminent leaders, Dadabhai Naroji and Gopal Krishna Gokhale. So this is Dadabhai Naroji. Okay, Dadabhai Naroji, and this one is Gopal Krishna Gokhale. Okay, so now we'll move on to some of the important facts, like some of the important leaders. So Dadabhai Naroji was there, Gopal Krishna Gokhale was there, Surendranath Banerjee was there. Okay, and then many more were there, like Badruddin Tyabji was also there. So they were early moderate leaders. Okay, so now the question arises over here: what were the beliefs of the moderates? The early nationalists, that is the moderates, they had unlimited faith in the British sense of justice. They felt that we'll place our demands in a very constitutional way, and whenever the English comes to know about our demand, they will definitely fulfill it. So it is mentioned over here that they felt that that stage of history, it was in their own interest to remain under the British, since they were not yet ready to govern themselves. So they felt that right now we are not ready to govern our country ourselves. So we need to be under the guidance of the Britishers. Okay. So in one sentence, if you ask me what were the beliefs of the moderates, and I can say that unlimited faith. That means the moderates had unlimited faith in the British sense of justice. So you can go through this sentence once again. You can see here what they felt. They felt that at that stage of history, it was not in their own interest to remain under the British, since they were not yet ready to govern themselves. So that means they were not at all ready to govern their country themselves. Okay, so they even were convinced that we need to introduce certain reforms. We need to demand certain reforms from them for our benefit. So it is mentioned over here. The early nationalists were convinced that the British could be persuaded to introduce necessary reforms, and the government could transfer to suit the interests of the Indian subject. That means we will request them, we will persuade them to introduce certain reforms for our country. Okay, so you can see here, this point you can see here, they had a great faith in the British sense of justice and fair play. That means simple, when they come to know about our demand, what all demands we want, then definitely they'll fulfill. That was their belief. Whether they were going to fulfill it or not, that is not at all sure. But one thing they believe, that once they come to know about our demand, okay, definitely they will fulfill. So you can see this unlimited faith in the British sense of justice. Okay, now we'll discuss about what they actually wanted. What were the objectives? What actually were the demands of the early nationalists? So you can see here, the early nationalists wanted proper participation of the Indians in the government. That means right now they are not ready. We don't want to throw the British out of the country. We cannot rule at this moment. So we want participation in the government. You rule the country. The British government, let them rule the country. But we also need participation in the government in the near future. Okay, slowly and gradually we'll move towards self-government. First of all, we have to learn how to govern our country. Okay, we have to learn how to govern our country. So it is mentioned over here that they wanted proper participation in the Indian government. Okay, they wanted, it means what was their objective? They wanted participation in the government, so that in near future, slowly and gradually, we will move towards our self-government. Okay, right now we don't want freedom. Right now we don't want Swaraj. We just want participation in the government. Okay, you rule the country, but let us also be the part of the government. Okay. Now, what all methods did they apply in order to achieve their objective? So let me tell you, they followed three P's: prayer, petition and protest. Prayer, petition and protest. These three P's were the most important method of the moderates. Okay, so moderates adopted peaceful constitutional method. They did not break any law. Okay, so they presented their grievances to the government and waited patiently for the government to pass laws to remove those grievances. I have a grievance within me. I will place my grievance in front of the English, and they will wait for that grievances to be removed by the Britishers. Okay, so this is the method. So they believed the government could gradually give into their demands. So slowly and gradually, one day or the other day, they are going to fulfill our demands. You don't understand? They followed prayer, protest, petitions and all. They sent petitions, they sent delegations and all. Okay, pamphlets were distributed, speeches were given in the public so that they definitely will become conscious of their political rights and all. They wanted participation of more and more people in the Congress so that unity can be developed among them. Okay, so they promoted unity. Okay, they promoted unity. Spread political awareness among the people, and build up strong public opinion through meetings. That means public meetings were organized, speeches were given over there, lectures were given over there, so that the innocent, illiterate people will understand why and what for they are fighting for, what are the demands, and what all these demands can bring changes in their life. Okay, they even send delegates to England. In England, the delegates were sent. Okay, so why these delegates were sent? The delegates were sent to England to request or persuade the British government to introduce necessary reforms. What they wanted, they needed necessary reforms within the country. You rule, we don't have a problem. But the thing is that we also want to be a part of the British administration. We want to learn, and side by side, we also want necessary reforms within the country. So what I wanted must reach to the government, no, so that they will look into that matter and fulfill it. Okay, so delegates were sent to England also. Okay, now demands of the early nationalists. You can see here. What were the demands of the early nationalists? You can see here. Reforms. What were the demands? Reforms for the welfare of all the sections of Indian society. That means the early nationalists wanted the British to introduce certain reforms for the welfare of the sections of the Indian society. They believed that the British would grant them their request if they were convinced that the demands were reasonable and just. So if this government is convinced that our demands are reasonable, then definitely they will fulfill it. Okay, so this is how they wanted to place their demands in a very, very constitutional way. Okay, this were the one. So we discussed about the belief also. They had unlimited faith in the British sense of justice. Then we discussed about the objectives. What were the objectives? Simple. They wanted participation in the government. Okay, they wanted participation in the government. And what were the demands? Reforms. They demanded reforms to be brought within the Indian society. Why? For the welfare of the sections of the Indian society. Okay, different sections are there in the country. So in every section, the reforms were required. So for that, they have to place that demand in front of the English. Okay, now, many of the historians are of the view that the early nationalists, they became unsuccessful. They were completely a failure. So initially, when we started, no, I told you from 1885 to 1905 was the era of the moderate. That means how many years? 20 years. So they ruled for how many years? 20 years. Okay. So within these 20 years, did they achieve anything? Or directly, they all were failures. So according to many of the historians, they feel that no, they completely did not fail. They were the one to promote a good base for the nationalist. Okay, so you can see here what were their achievements. You can see here early nationalist, this point number one. The early nationalist established a solid foundation. You can see here solid foundation, which served as a base for the more radical approach in the later years. So today I prepared a base for you. So tomorrow somebody else will use the platform. So how it is possible? When we give a strong foundation. Okay, so early nationalists established a solid foundation to serve the future radicals to continue with their movement. Okay, then you can see a point number two. They spread political awareness. So people were made politically aware. Why are we fighting? What is the need of these reforms? Okay, so people were made aware by the moderates. Political awareness, political consciousness was instilled among the Indians by the moderates and all. Okay, and due to this awareness, my dear, a sense of national unity also was developed. We all are one. We must be together. National unity was born. That means national unity could be seen due to the efforts of the moderates. Okay. Now the people began to think themselves as a member of one single nation. People started to believe that we all belong to one single nation. Okay. Now, next one you can see here. The Congress under the early nationalists trained. You can see here. Train the Indians in the political affairs. So we normally are not at all interested in politics, right? But the early nationalists, what did they do? They trained the common people about the political affairs, what is happening in the country, what is the effect of English rule in our country, they stay in India for a longer period. So all these things were instilled in them through the efforts of the moderates. Okay, so they even educated the political them in the political matters. They educated them in the political matters. Okay, that means the moderates educated the common people related to political matters also. Okay, now you can see here on the top, you can see, let me bring it. Okay, they even made them familiarize with the ideas of freedom. What actually is freedom? What is the meaning of freedom? Okay, what is the meaning of freedom? Government, what is the meaning of government? What is the meaning of democracy? What is the meaning of secularism? What is the meaning of nationalism? All this was made clear to the Indians by the effort of the moderates. So moderates made the people familiarize with the ideas of freedom, government, democracy, secularism, nationalism. What is meaning of freedom? We all are born free, isn't it? We all have the right to live freely. Everywhere we need freedom. Government, what is the duty of the government? What are the basic objectives of the government? What is the duty of the government? So that was made clear to them. Then what is the meaning of democracy? Democracy is a rule by the people. So we have the right to rule our country. What is the meaning of secularism? There should not be any differences in any religion. Okay, nationalism, we all must be ready to serve for our nation. This country belongs to everyone. We all belong to this country. Okay, so we cannot be separated by caste and creed. We all are one. We all belong to the same nation. We all must love our country together. If there is any danger coming for our country or our nation is in danger, we all must be ready to save our country from those dangers and all. Okay, so this knowledge of training in political affairs helped Indian nationalists to organize and raise a national movement to the next stage of development. So all this work and the effort gave a platform for the radicals later on, isn't it? So moderates altogether were not failure. If they could have started a violent movement against the Britishers, Britishers could have stopped them. But what did they do? They prepared a foundation. They gave a strong base for the national movement. That is why, you know, later on radicals continued, then Gandhiji came and continued the movement. If the moderates could have been violent and they could have straightforward fought with the Britishers could have suppressed them easily. And the story of the movement could have ended then and there. They did not do so. They were highly intellectuals. Okay, they knew we need to fight very cautiously with the Britishers, because our Indians are not at all ready about their demands and all. They have not understood the real cause of freedom, why we want freedom. Okay, they need to be, that means we need to form ideas, we need to form public opinions for the Indians first, then only we can become successful. Okay, so the belief of the early nationalists, we all know that. They only wanted a peaceful, orderly change. They want a peaceful, orderly change, secular approach to the national problem. Okay, so all this were the achievements of the moderates. Moderates, okay. So for 20 years, we say that moderates did not achieve anything. Though many of the demands, whichever they wanted from the Britishers could not be achieved, but they became successful in giving a strong base and foundation for the national movement, which could continue later on smoothly. Okay, so next one you can see here. As you all know that the young group within the Congress were not very happy with the work of the moderates of prayer, petition and all. So within the Congress, a young group was there. They rose to power, right? They were known as radicals. The young wing within the Congress who were not happy with the working style of moderates, they now came to be known as radicals. They also came to be known as assertive nationalists. Okay, so from 1905 to 1918, that was the era of the radicals. Okay, so who were some of the important leaders? Moderates were also congressmen. Radicals are also congressmen. What is the difference? Their method and approach is different. Their method and approach to achieve their objective is different. Okay, so you can see here some of the important radical leaders' names are given over here. So you can see Bal Gangadhar Tilak is there, Lala Lajpat Rai is there, Bipin Chandra Pal is there, again Aurobindo Ghosh is also there. Okay, so their political beliefs, aims, methods were completely different from the moderates. Moderates' beliefs, moderates' demand, moderate method was not at all comparable with the extreme. That means radical. That means it was completely different. So whatever method they followed was completely different from the method which the radicals followed. So when I discuss about the belief, objectives and the methods of the radicals, you will surely understand what actually are the differences between the moderates and the extremists. The assertives. Okay, so moderate is also a congressman, radical is also a congressman. What is the difference? Their viewpoint is different, their objective is different, their method to achieve their objective is different. Okay, this assertives, or we can say the radicals, they became frustrated by seeing these moderates pleading, requesting, sending petitions, and at the end nothing was achieved. They couldn't, that means not a single demand was fulfilled by the Britishers. Okay, now very simple, what were the belief of the moderates? What were the belief of the moderates? Simple, they had no faith. They had, that means moderates had unlimited faith. Once again, let me tell you, moderates had unlimited faith, whereas radicals, they had no faith. It is mentioned over here, no faith in the British sense of justice. They had unlimited faith, but here the radicals had no faith in the British sense of justice. So what did they believe? They believed that British rule in India is a curse. British rule in India was not a blessing, but a curse. Okay, see here, this is the sentence. They believe that British rule in India was not a blessing, but a curse. See that. They believe that, moderates believe that it was due to the Britishers that we are brought out of the darkness to light, isn't it? They brought education, they brought changes, okay? Social reform they brought. They thought that they are the guide to them. They are the boon to the Indians. But the radicals believe that the British rule in India was not a blessing, but a curse, okay? So they were convinced that British had no intention of introducing any reforms. They understood that Britishers will never introduce any reforms for the welfare of the Indians. They are not going to bring any changes. Did you understand? So they realized that the British interests were different. They understood they are here not for our welfare. They are here for their personal interests, for growing their own economy. They wanted to progress their economy. They wanted to exploit our Indian resources. They are here to exploit our country. Okay, so they have not come here for the welfare of the Indians. Okay, so that was clear to the radicals. So see the pictures of these radicals. Leaders like Lala Lajpat Rai is there, isn't it? Then Bal Gangadhar Tilak is there. Then Bipin Chandra Pal is there. So all these are the extremist trio or radicals. Lal, Bal and Pal. In short, they are also known as Lal, Bal and Pal. Okay, so next. What were the objectives? The objective was only one, Swaraj. We want nothing else than Swaraj. Okay, so what were the objectives of the moderates? Welfare of the people, isn't it? Participation, certain reforms in the country. So here, completely different. They simply want one thing. What they wanted? Swaraj. They wanted immediate freedom. Freedom means Swaraj. They wanted complete freedom from the British rule. Is that clear? Now, what were the methods? Like the moderates followed the 3 P's, prayer, petition, protest, speeches were given in the public, people were made aware of the political condition of the country, political consciousness was brought among the people. But here they followed, what did they follow? You can see here, they followed, let me tell you, they followed Swadeshi, boycott, okay? They followed Swadeshi, boycott, national education, revivalism. Okay, you can see here. Okay, so it is not mentioned over here, but let me tell you, they followed Swadeshi, boycott, national education and revivalism. Okay, that means boycott of foreign goods, use of Indian goods. Okay, so they are traders. They are not rulers. They have not come in India to rule. They have come initially as a trader. So how can we affect their economy by not using or buying their goods? So what we have to do? We have to boycott the foreign-made goods. Okay. Okay. Now you can see here. Yeah? During this period only, when we talk about Swadeshi and boycott, when the movement was becoming popular day by day, isn't it? So as you all know that when Indian National Congress was founded, the English supported them. So we also call that A.O. Hume was the founder of Indian National Congress, isn't it? So that we all know it. But slowly and gradually, when the demands of the moderates and the extremists went on increasing, they decided to break the unity of the people of Bengal. So what did they plan for? Now they decided to partition Bengal. So in the year 1905, you can see here, in the year 1905, they decided to partition Bengal. Okay, and they did also. The British partitioned Bengal in 1905 in pursuance of their policy of divide and rule. That means what were the objectives? To divide and rule. First of all, let us divide Bengal and then we will rule. So we know their policy is always this only, to divide and rule. Okay, so after the partition of Bengal in the year 1905, my dear, the assertive nationalists adopted the method of boycott, Swadeshi, national education. So as I told you, no, their objectives were different. Their methods were also different. So what they wanted Swaraj. And in order to achieve their objectives, they followed Swadeshi, boycott, national education. So now this is the time. This is a time when partition of Bengal is taking place, and in order to stop the partition of Bengal, what did they do? They decided, they adopted the method of boycott. You can see here, boycott, Swadeshi, national education. Now, boycott, what is the meaning of boycott? Not to use the foreign goods. Okay, if I say boycott of foreign goods, means we are not going to use the foreign goods. When we say boycott of schools and colleges, we will not go to schools and colleges. Okay, boycott of liquor, foreign liquors, we are not going to use the foreign liquors. Okay, side by side, when we are boycotting everything, then we need goods also, Indian goods also. So for that, they promoted Swadeshi. Swadeshi means now onward, we are going to use the goods made in our own country. Goods made in our own country. Okay, now people were asked, you can see here. People were asked to boycott the British goods, okay? Boycott the British goods and use only Indian or Swadeshi goods. Indians, people were asked, use Swadeshi goods, goods made in our country, and boycott the goods made in foreign countries, okay? Simple, boycott foreign goods and use Indian goods. Indian goods means Swadeshi goods. Swadeshi means goods made in our own country. Okay, so this paragraph you can see here, the assertive nationalists also saw through the evil design of British in dividing Bengal on communal lines. Bengal was divided on communal lines. Okay, the way they partitioned Bengal, no, half of the Muslims went on the eastern part of Bengal and the rest of the Hindus, they were left behind the West Bengal. Okay, so this partition. Actually, why partition took place earlier? Why Indians were ready to accept the partition? They made the people, that means they convinced the people that we are going to partition Bengal for administrative reason. You can see here, this entire part, Bengal is too large a territory to be governed by one single governor. One single governor cannot administer it properly, isn't it? Okay, this is the part, see here. So once again, let me do it properly from here. Okay, Bhutan will not be included. See here, Bengal. So you can see here, it included the old Bengal, proper Bengal included. Bengal is also there. Okay, Assam is also there. Bihar is also there. Okay, Odisha also is there. You can see here, this also. This part also will come. This part also will come. Okay. Assam, Bengal, Bihar. Okay. So all these were proper Bengal. So now how did they partition? They partition in such a way. See, pinkish part, right? This part. This was East Bengal and this is West Bengal. This is how. So this part maximum Muslims were there and this part Hindus were there. So the partition itself made a clear indication to the nationalists that this partition is not for administrative reason, but this is done in order to break the unity of the Hindus and the Muslims. Hindus and the Muslims. Okay, so when you reach class 10, I'll explain you in detail. Okay, so right now only in short paragraph, partition of Bengal took place in 1995. Why was partition in Bengal? From the point of nationalist view, it was partitioned in order to break the unity of the Hindus and the Muslims. Okay, is that clear? Now we'll move on to the next topic. Now you know that moderates and the extremists were working together. When in 1905, when the radicals decided to go for Swadeshi and boycott in order to stop the partition of Bengal, at that time moderates were not ready to follow this. Moderates said, no, we are not going to do so. Moderates did not do it. But in 1906, they said, okay, let us go with Swadeshi and boycott. But finally, in the year 1907, you can see here, in 1907, there was a split within the Congress. Within the Congress, moderates and the extremists were separated. Okay? Moderates and the extremists were separated. Okay? Actually, the session was supposed to be held at Nagpur. Okay? Let me tell you, it is not mentioned over here. Surat split. Let me tell you. Actually, in 1907, the session of the Congress was supposed to be held at Nagpur, but at the last moment, for the convenience of the moderates, the venue was shifted to Surat from Nagpur. Okay, that is number one reason. And number two is that even the leader like Bal Gangadhar Tilak was not at all allowed to give a speech in the session. Okay, that is why there was a confusion and there was a difference of opinion between the moderates and the extremists. You see, differences already we have seen. Their method is different, isn't it? Moderates' belief is different, extremists' belief is different. They wanted participation, here they want complete Swaraj. So when the partition of Bengal took place, they wanted to continue with the Swadeshi and boycott, whereas moderates said, no, we cannot go against the British's English rule. That is why there was a difference of opinion, as at that time the moderates were very strong, so they separated the extremist, the assertive nationalist from the moderates. Okay, from the council, there was a rift between the moderates and the extremists. That means Congress was broken into two parts, moderates and the extremists, and this continued till 1916. Okay, this continued till 1916, you can see here, 1916, okay, is that clear? So now this is all about the separation, that means Surat split means in Surat session, there was a split within the moderates and the extremists. That means Congress was divided into two parts, moderates and the extremists, okay, and later on, Tilak was sentenced to 6 years of imprisonment also. 6 years of imprisonment. Okay. Now, in 1906, formation of Muslim League. So why Muslim League was formed? So let me give you a short idea. Because the movement which was launched in the year 1905, which was known as anti-partisan movement or the Swadeshi and boycott movement. So in that, many of the things which they used was completely against the Muslim religion, right? Like taking vow in front of goddess Kali and all, taking bath in holy river and all, tying the band of Rakhi in the hands of each other, okay? And so this way, my dear, they did not feel, but all those communalism was instilled in the minds of the Muslims by the English that this organization is a Hindu organization, okay? So they now also decided to form a separate organization. So in the year 1906, 31st December 1906, most of the Indian leaders met at Dhaka to attend one of the educational conference at Dhaka. And many of the Muslim leaders like Nawab Salimullah of Dhaka was there, isn't it? Mohammad Ali Jinnah, they all now decided, why not we have a separate organization to safeguard the interests of the Muslims? So everybody said, okay, why not? Let us go forward with this. So Muslim League was founded in the year 1906. So 31st December, okay, let me tell you whether it is mentioned over here or not. It is not there. So 31st Okay, so there was a 31st of December 1906 in Muslim League was founded. Muslim League was formed. Okay, and what were the immediate objectives? Like when Muslim League, when Congress was formed, at that time also objectives were there. So you can see here also we have certain objectives, like number one, you can see here three objectives mainly. Number one, to promote among the Muslims a feeling of loyalty. That means we have to be loyal to the English. We have to be loyal. We should show our loyalty for the English. So to be loyal to the English, number one. Number two, to protect and promote the political right of the Muslims. To protect and promote the political right of the Muslims. We have to protect our rights. We have to protect our interest also. Okay. And number three, to prevent the feeling of hostility towards other countries. We should not be with the Congress. We have to separate ourselves. Now we are completely separated ourselves from the Congress. Okay, number one, to be loyal to the English. Number two, to prevent the feeling of hostility towards other communities. Okay, and number three, to protect and promote the political right of the Muslims. Okay, and number four, let us say, to present our demands in front of the English in a very constitutional way. Okay, so this is what they wanted. Is that clear? Now, let us move on to the First War and India. The First World War, now in 1914, right? First World War started, and during this time, what was the move of the Indians? That is mentioned over here. Okay. Okay. So this is all about Muslim League also we have done. So now, First World War. So see here, the outbreak of First World War in 1914 had a significant effect on the national movement. Okay, as a colony of the British Empire, India was automatically drawn into the war. As India was with the British, India was a colony of the British Empire. So when Britain was involved in the war, so automatically India was also involved in the war. Okay, so you can see initially there was an outburst of loyalty, and the Indian leaders supported the British government with men and money. Okay, more than a million, you can see here, more than a million Indian soldiers were sent overseas to join the British army. Okay, so this is the time when the First World War was started. This is the time when the movement was not taking place. They were silent. The Indian leaders said, this is not the time to disturb the British during the war. Okay. You can see here. So it's all about the British and the Allies declared that they were fighting the war to make the world safe for democracy, to promote the right of all the national to form self-government. Okay, so okay, this is all. So okay, now this is the topic we want to discuss. Home Rule League. Okay. So when First World War started, the Indian movement was kept on hold, and this was a time when extremists became very, very active. Bal Gangadhar Tilak was released from the prison. Okay, and now he decided to organize a movement first. So what did he do? He decided to make the people politically aware. Okay, he decided to make the people politically aware. For that, he started a Home Rule League in 1916. In 1916, he started a Home Rule League. Okay, so during this period, Annie Besant also joined him. Okay, so they decided this part up to Maharashtra, Bal Gangadhar Tilak will go and make the people politically conscious. So together, Bal Gangadhar Tilak as well as Annie Besant together, they spread the Home Rule movement to different parts of the country. Okay, so the main aim. So what was the main aim? So the main aim of the league was to achieve self-government within the British Empire after the war. So after the war, what they wanted? They wanted self-government. So it is mentioned over here. They wanted a self-government within the British Empire soon after the war. Okay, so Tilak and Annie Besant traveled. Okay. Tilak and Annie Besant traveled. Tilak and Annie Besant traveled all over the country, spreading the message of freedom and self-rule. Freedom and self-rule. And this movement became very, very popular. So which movement? Home Rule movement became very, very popular. Okay. Now, Lucknow session of the Congress 1916. So Lucknow session. So another important development during the war was change in attitude of the Muslim towards the British. Okay. So the last section of, you can see the sentence, the large section, okay, large section of educated Muslims began to support the national movement. So why this happened? Why there is a certain change in the what you call objectives of the Muslim League? Because after the First World War, the Muslim sentiment was hurt. Now you may say, how, sir? That means after the war, treaty of Sivriz was signed with Turkey, like Germany and his friends were defeated. Okay, on one side, Germany, Turkey, Austria, Hungary was there. Okay, so Germany had to sign Treaty of Versailles. Along with Germany, Austria also had to sign Treaty of Saint-Germain. And Turkey also was fighting from the side of Germany. So finally, now they all are defeated. So Treaty of Sivriz was signed with Turkey also. So by signing the Treaty of Sivriz, my dear, Turkey had lost its previous position. Now you may say, so what is the connection with the Indian Muslims? Let me tell you, the rulers of Turkey were known as Khalifas. Khalifas were regarded as the successors of Prophet Muhammad. So highly they were respected by the Muslims in India. So in India, Muslims thought that we are very, very close and loyal to the Britishers. So if we request them to restore back the lost position of the Khalifas of Turkey, they will listen to us. But you see here, the British government refused to do so. British government refused to do so. That is why the Muslim sentiment was hurt and they decided to start a movement, and that movement came to be known as Khilafat movement. Okay, so all this we'll discuss in detail in when you reach class 10. Okay, so you can see here names of two brothers, Ali brothers. See here, Maulana. Okay, yeah, you can see here Maulana Muhammad Ali and Maulana Shaukat Ali. Okay. So two Ali brothers, that means Muhammad Ali and Shaukat Ali, two brothers started a movement known as Khilafat movement against the Britishers. Okay, and later on, when the Khilafat of Turkey was abolished, Khilafat movement also was merged with the non-cooperation movement. That we'll discuss in the next chapter. Okay, so during this change, my dear, we saw in Lucknow session was held, and one of the most important aspect of Lucknow session of the Congress was that Muslim League and the Congress were now united. They came together. So Lucknow pact cemented the unity between the Hindus and the Muslims. Okay, Hindus and Muslims were back together with separate objectives, separate agenda, but we'll be fighting together against the Britishers. Okay, So this is all about from this chapter number 13, the Indian National Movement from 1885 to 1916. In 1885, Indian National Congress was founded, and in 1916, Lucknow session of Congress was held, in which both the Muslim League and the Congress were united. Okay, another important thing was that moderates and extremists also were united. You can see here in 1916. So this is the C. In 1916, pen is not working. So 1916. And here also you see, this is also 1916. So in 1916, two important developments took place. Number one, unity between the, that means moderates came back and joined with the Congress. Moderates and the extremists were united. Okay, Bal Gangadhar Tilak was released, joined back the Congress, started the Home Rule movement and all. And the other hand, Muslim League and the Congress were also united. So this is all from this chapter. Okay, hope you all have understood it. So go through it. While going through this, please keep the book in front of you and listen to me properly so that you can do it properly. Okay, so where is the first page? Okay, so the chapter number 13, Indian National Movement, 1885-1916 is over. So in the next chapter, we'll discuss about chapter number 14, Indian National Movement from 1917 onward. Okay, 1917 onward. Okay, till then, take care, stay safe. Bye-bye.